The corporate-controlled media has let BP off the hook, not just for their crimes in the Gulf of Mexico, but for their crimes all over the country. But we aren't willing to give the company a free pass for killing Americans and destroying the environment. And I have investigative journalist Rick Outzen with me now to talk about the criminal history of BP. Rick, thanks for joining me.
Oh, it's good to be here, Farron.
I know over the years, you know, in the immediate days following the spill and even up till today, basically, you've been one of the few people out there consistently writing about the BP oil spill. And it's not just the BP oil spill. You've written about the refinery explosions and things like that. But the reason this is still such an important story is because you have BP executives out there right now trying to basically try this case to the national media. You know, what's going on?
Well, what they've already tried it. They've begun an 800 number where they're saying that they want people to send out any evidence they have of fraudulent claims. They have gone to the federal court judge and asked him to suspend any further payments on claims while they investigate this fraudulent and they claim, you know, conflicts of interest and all these things to muddy the water. And of course, fortunately, the court system isn't buying any of it, but they are spending almost $500 million trying to get their message across to the rest of the country. They want the rest of the country to believe that the Gulf Coast are just sucking off them and, you know, creating all these nightmares that aren't really true. And of course, having lived here and having covered it, we know that we're far from the end of this crisis.
Right. And, you know, as you point out, they're willing to spend $500 million
right
on public relations, you know, to make themselves look good, to set up these things, to paint the actual victims as the, you know, bad guy in this situation. So they're willing to spend this $500 million, but they're not willing to pay out, you know, a $5,000 claim or a $10,000 claim. And like you pointed out with this fraud line, this has actually backfired on the company. They wanted people to call in and say, hey, Joe Smith down the street submitted a claim. I know he doesn't
right
have one. But instead, what's happening is people are calling in and saying, BP, you guys are committing fraud. You committed fraud when you lied about the amount of oil flowing out of the wellhead. So this has been a complete backfire. But it's not stopping people, you know, BP executives like Dudley, from going out there to the media, you know, CNBC, Fox News, all these outlets, and they are able to control the message and spin the story how they want to.
Oh, without a doubt, Farron. I mean, we had, you know, Robert Dudley, the CEO, who was paid, by the way, $6.8 million the year after the BP oil spill. Got a, you know, five times what he made the year before. And he goes to Bloomberg and Business Week and does an interview and talks about how, you know, how bad it is that people in the United States hate oil companies. That all over the world, everyone else loves their industry, but it's these ambulance chasing lawyers and these blood sucking Southerners along the Gulf Coast, these fishermen, these business owners that are drying them out, and they're the problem, not BP. We're the problem, which is so far from the truth.
And they're vilifying these people. Like you said, they're fishermen. They're fourth, fifth, sixth generation fishermen. That's all they've ever done. That's how they've entire family for generations has made their living. Yeah, that's not the bad guy. Tony Hayward, I just want my life back.
Right.
That is a bad guy in this situation. BP, who refused to spend the extra money to make that Deepwater Horizon oil rig safe, that's a bad guy. And still, they're out there in the media, they're spending this hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars convincing the rest of the country, not the people down here. The people down here know. But they're making the rest of the country believe that everyone down here is just trying to get a quick payday, a couple thousand dollars from BP, even though it didn't affect them, and just move on with their day. But at least the judge isn't buying it, which is a great thing.
It is, you know, but well, let's really look at what the facts that happened at this oil spill. It happened on April 20th, 2010. They didn't completely close off that well until September of the same year. We know that 210 million gallons of crude oil were spilled, gushed into the Gulf. They tried to hide it. Originally, they told us it was only about 1,000 barrels a day. And then they had us thinking that they could cap it in May. They were doing all these things that they were trying to act like it was going to work when
all the experts... Stuffing it with garbage.
Yeah, really. It was mad scientist type stuff, and using robots and all that. And all the experts were telling us this can't happen. They're going to have to cap it. They're going to have to drill a second well. It wasn't until late June that they admitted that, and it wasn't until September that it actually worked. But we had 210 million gallons of crude. We had another almost 2 million gallons of dispersants, coexert, which made everything 52 times more toxic than it was just to have the oil. You know, and then now what we're hearing, and this is what Dudley doesn't want anyone to talk about, this is what BP won't run any ads on, but we're seeing there's about a 50-mile radius of that well where sea life is dead. We're seeing that we just had a report come out about, you know, the high level of carcinogens inside whales, which are the top of the food chain in the Gulf. We're seeing that there are reports on the people that work to clean up this mess, who were out there at the rig soaking it in. You know, they're coming up with all sorts of markers that are showing that they're going to have health issues from years to come. They're coughing, breathing, skin, headaches. They've done studies, they reported it this year at one of the conferences here in Florida, that they're having a lot of depression, a lot of PTSD issues that they're dealing with. Children that are 10 miles away from the actual Gulf Coast, they're reporting, you know, horrible health conditions, bleeding ears, bloody noses. The girls are going into menstruation much earlier than they do in other parts of the country. This thing is growing, and Dudley and BP, they want to shut it down as quick as they can, but and not let anyone understand how bad this really is.
Well, you brought up a very interesting point about the fact that in the early days of the spill, they said, oh, it's only about 1,000 barrels right. a day, and then it was 2,000, then 5, then 10, then 20. But about a year before the oil spill happened, BP, in their own, I believe it's called Horizons Magazine, they wrote an article bragging about the fact that they personally, BP had developed a technology that could determine the flow rate of a broken wellhead on the ocean floor. They right. created the technology, and all of a sudden, when it actually happens, they can't use it? No, and that's why the federal government has already popped them for fraud on that issue, because they deceived the public, they deceived the government, they deceived everybody. And they did that because if they truly knew how much oil was coming out of that wellhead, that affects how much money they get fined under right. the Clean Water Act. So again, all of this, everything this company does is about saving money. And it's saving money, or their attempt to save money, that caused this disaster in the first place. I know shortly after the spill, you uncovered this brilliant document from BP. It was called The Three Little
Three
Pigs.
Little Pigs.
Tell us about that.
Well, in the Texas City refinery, which happened in 2005, 4 years before, they had an explosion, killed 15 people, injured almost 180 people, millions upon millions, billions of dollars worth of fines and payouts they had to do to people because of the injuries. But what we found that within their own training manuals, they created a document that they called it, not us, the Three Little Pigs, where they decided that there were three ways to handle the issues at the Texas City refinery. When they were doing a construction project, they were putting construction offices and housing close to the project, and they had three decisions to make. They could do it a house of straw, which would be relatively inexpensive trailer. That you would see nothing very special about it. They could build a house of stone or sticks, which would be a little bit more reinforced, and it would be able to handle a certain amount of explosion. Or they could have gone with the deluxe house of brick, which would have withstood the blast that they had to deal with. And what the way they made their decision was they put $1 million value on every life that was lost. And they figured out that the cheapest way in the long run for them to go was with the house of straw, so that they could suffer the whatever the loss was in human life. They figured it was going to be $1 million less. That would be how much more profit they could make. They gambled with those lives they lost. But the Three Little Pig memo went international, because it really showed their heart.
Well, it does. It shows that, you know, they make these formulas. And it's not just BP. The pharmaceutical companies do this. The insurance companies do this. They build in the cost. Like, okay, we know that eventually, you know, X amount of people are going to be killed. But before that happens, we can make Y amount of dollars. They do the equation and say, you know what? We're still going to make more money if we let these people die, then pay the settlements and the fines, and we're still going to come out on top. So consumers be damned. It doesn't matter if we kill people with our daily operations. That doesn't matter. As long as we can make money off those graves is what they're doing.
Well, BP has a formula that they operate with. We've seen it. We saw it. What a lot of people don't realize, Exxon Valdez, BP was in charge of the cleanup of Exxon Valdez, not Exxon. We saw how they operated there. We saw what happened in the Texas City refinery. And what we came up with the oil spills, we saw a game plan that they use in these kind of events. They try to immediately go out after the political leaders and co-opt them. We saw very early on that Governor Charlie Crist here in Florida they gave him $25 million to help his administration deal with this. He was meeting with Tony Hayward. Mississippi, they did the same thing. Jindal in Louisiana got a little bit off the playbook with them, but because he was actually seeing oil on his shores, he had to do something to save his community. The next thing we saw that they would do, they would come in and mitigate the risk. They would come up with, try to downplay the 1,000 barrels a day. Top hat was going to be the magic formula for capping the wealth. And they get that initial buzz from that, and then later on they have to come back and retract what they said. But the retraction never gets the same amount of play. And then the last thing that we saw was they tried to put a whole lot of money on the Gulf Coast, in small amounts, but a lot of money, to try to calm people down. They hired the commercial fishermen, pay them $5,000 a day. What they didn't tell anybody, and we were the ones that found it, was they had tried to get them to sign waivers that they would never file claims. We were able to get that stopped. They came out and were giving restaurant workers checks for $2,000 and $3,000, $4,000, but they weren't paying the restaurants. They would handle the workers and get moving money out there. So, what we're seeing now is now the businesses are stepping up. Their claims are much larger than BP ever thought it would be. They're trying to get out of their settlement agreement. They're trying to, and they did this very early on, and this, it doesn't surprise me. They're attacking the attorneys that are helping these businesses file their claims, because in the beginning, Farron, they didn't want anyone to have a CPA. They didn't want to have anyone to have an attorney with these claims. And we had to fight for that because these things are complicated. But so, what we're seeing now is they want to shut it down. They want to act like there's a big problem. They want to get their lives back is what they want. And we're not going to let them.